affect the funding of different UN funds and agencies. And I mean, it is a bit of our concern that history will repeat itself. If you look back at 2006, the UN Population Fund took a hard hit in terms of funding. So we'll see what will happen next year. In realizing all of these goals, men and boys play a crucial role. Particular attention needs to be paid to the changing of gender norms. Prevailing notions of masculinity and femininity need to be discussed and challenged. Men and boys must engage in this process. In the United Nations, the UN Women is our main partner in promoting these ideas. The partnership between Finland and UN Women has grown stronger over the years, and we are determined to support UN Women in carrying out its crucial work, and we have been one of its main donors over the past years. Our core funding contribution has been $10 million in 2016. And we greatly value UN Women's work and will continue to champion for the gender equality together. You might have heard about the UN Women He for She initiative. It is a great example of how to bring men and women, girls and boys together to work towards gender equality. Through local, regional and global campaigns and social media, the initiative has grown into a global change-making movement reaching millions of people. In conclusion, I would like to refer to some activities, actions of the Finnish president, male, after 12 years of a female rule. We have a male again. Many children, they couldn't believe that they were asking, well, can a male become a president as well? And it happened. Yeah, but our male president, he's a gender champion. He's a he-for-she impact a champion. And actually, it's not only policy or rhetorics. He has made also a commitment, a concrete commitment, and it is related to the training of our conscripts. We are one of the few countries left in Europe which still has a conscript system, a universal draft. So all males, they have to serve either in the military or do their civil service. So this initiative of the president, which is related to the He4She Impact Champion campaign, it is about anger management training of the conscripts, which is a very concrete method. I mean, these young men, they are 19, 20 years old. I think the perception of women and gender equality hasn't quite developed yet, so it's a good way and means to influence them during the military service. So with this, I conclude my presentation, and I thank you for your attention, and looking forward to the panel. Thank you very much.
Great, thank you so much for that. Next, we're going to call up Richard Louis, who is the news anchor for MSNBC and NBC News since 2010. Perhaps the most recognizable face in this audience here. And formerly, he was at CNN Worldwide. And of course, Richard Louis has a long career in business and journalism, but for our purposes here, I thought the most interesting thing is that his reporting has focused on humanitarian issues, including gender equality and human trafficking. And his charity work in these areas led him to work with Plan International USA as a global ambassador for the Because I Am a Girl campaign. And Richard's work and reporting on humanitarian issues spans 30 years and six continents, apparently. And he has received civil rights awards from organizations such as the Asian American Journalists Association and others. And you will find much more information about him online on the NBC News website and Wikipedia. Richard, we're looking forward to hearing from you.
Well, good morning, everybody. How is Prescott Rose today? Are we in the 27th floor? On the 27th floor. Jana, thank you so much for those kind remarks, Mr. Ambassador as well, for opening today's event, because this is such an important conversation that we're about to embark on. And I think the topic is so basic and so important, yet we don't talk about it. And as Jana was saying, my, if you will, nexus to this topic and my interest in gender equality was, well, it has a lot to do with serendipity. I started by reporting on trafficking at CNN, doing an undercover piece on, at the time, a brothel where there were 14 and 15-year-old girls. This is back in 2008. And then that just moved to another space where I was at an event, a Women's Alliance event in Washington, D.C., and this fellow friend of all of us, her name is Judith Register, came up to me after the event and said, Richard, we'd love for you to become an ambassador for Plan International because I'm a girl. And I was like, well, I don't know why I would be that person. If you just look at me, I'm not sure if I'm the first person you think of being that person, along with some very amazing individuals like Frida Pinto and Marcia Cross, and there's Richard Louie. But she saw it, and she saw very early on, because we had these long conversations about why gender equality meant that we needed everybody in the room together. And she talked about it in very complex ways. And that brought me to meet another amazing individual who will be on the panel later, is Anthony DeJong over at UN Women, who has been a strong partner with Judith along the path. And then it was he for she. And that was so obvious about why we need to be that. As Mr. Ambassador, you mentioned a moment ago about why he for she is so important as the United Nations works towards that. So it is with great pleasure that I get to be here to talk about this stuff, because it's we got to talk about it. And so stop us as we're moving along in the conversation when we do sit down and if we get off basis. But I wanted to share some remarks about how I like to talk about the issue, because it did start with, for me, human trafficking, and then moving into how I understood gender inequality to be the very fundamental reason as to why we can treat any human the way we do when we talk about trafficking. And so I'd like to characterize that problem of gender inequality with some words that I like to bring up that are often associated with it. I mean, when you hear the words human trafficking, what are the first words that you associate it with it? Prostitution, sex, exploitation. Yes, and those are the words. It's often that, women, girls, right? Those are the other words you associate with that when you think of human trafficking. Issues of race, what are the words you think of? Black, African-American in this country. Inequality. Sexual orientation? Slavery? LGBT? Kidnapping? That's right. It's about gays, right? That's often what people often will say. Gender? What are the words you associate with that? Women? Women, that's right. Feminism? Angry women? Right? I mean, these are all the words that, if we're really honest, what pops up in our mind. And you can tell, especially in this group, how we're associating the wrong words, right? We're not, our brains and culture sort of put it that way. And it's sort of the insipid nature of sexism and misogyny, these words that we often use and that what they connote. And there was a gentleman that I got to meet, his name is Jackson Katz, who really sort of brought that home for me. He's a trainer on gender equality. And he says that all of us, men and women, are conditioned by one dominant group's perspective on culture and language. And in that case, as you can probably guess, it's a male's view. And it's sort of an unspoken reality, a problem of gender inequality that really is, it gives us a sort of fertile ground for these travesties that we're talking about, as extreme as human trafficking is for sexual exploitation and everything else that we can talk about. And in most cases, it is a this is a human rights violation. It's as old as the human race, as we have often heard about. Women as second-class citizens, some arguing that, you know, if you just look back in the Bible, that that is absolutely the case with Adam and Eve, right? Who has the apple? It was a woman that did that, right? And so today in 2016, I think, though, despite that, there are two very opposite renaissances that are at loggerheads in this fight for women and girls' rights as we think about it. One is bad and one is good. And I'm going to start with the bad one, the bad renaissance, if you will, and it's a pandemic. If you look at the numbers of slaves today in our world, that number is greater than at any point in the history of the world. We also have more money involved in slavery than any point in the history of the world. And we're talking about 2016. We'd think that we would have moved ahead, but we haven't. And so when you look at that history, that line chart, for those of you who like line charts, we're at that nadir. We're at the bottom. And it's only getting worse, if you can believe that. I mean, the estimated number of slaves, according to the United Nations International Labor Organization, the ILO, they actually raised their estimate, their slave estimate, from 12 million last decade to 21 million in 2012. And we have another estimate that could be as large as 200 million, and that's really shocking. The amount of profit related to this, when we talk about trading human flesh, that was also recently assessed from $30 billion before U.S. dollars to $150 billion U.S. And, you know, when you talk about countries, there's no land, there's no country that is excluded in this. In every corner of the world, we have human trafficking. And it is the group of women and girls that are often that definition. Three out of four trafficking victims are female. The UN estimates that, and here is why. It's a male problem. Those who buy, sell, and rent these slaves, they're men, and they constitute 67% of convicted traffickers when you look at the numbers. So those are the numbers, but we kind of know that, don't we? There was one individual that I got to tell a story about. His name was Amador Cortez Meza, and he trafficked women and girls up and down the Eastern and Southern human trafficking corridors, because there are corridors in the United States where women and girls are trafficked, just like drugs. And there was one survivor, and I'll just call her Maria, because that's the name we had to use when we told her story about Cortez Meza. And he would rent women for weeks to local businesses, local pimps up and down this Eastern corridor, and they would be forced in what we call residential brothels to have sex 40, 50, 60 times a day. Maria was, when she told me, was required to have sex 100 times a day, is what she told me. And you think to yourself, that's not physically possible. But it was. And she and others were subjugated by Cortez Meza. They were kept in these downstairs cages, and they were like animals all across this Eastern corridor. Then there are the Johns. And, you know, ABT Associates estimates here 15% of men in the U.S., 15%, so view that math, have bought commercial sex in this country. And if we use that estimate to scale that worldwide, we're talking about 500 million men or more that have paid for sex in the world. And many of them do so. They buy it with women, men, girls, and boys. This is all illegal. And statistics available on Johns, though, you know, although we're trying to scale that out, for all that we do, we look at numbers associated with the victims. We don't look at those who are actually causing them to be victims. If you try to find numbers on Johns, good luck. Good luck. There's tons of data on the victims and the survivors. And that has been surprising for me, as I've told stories not only at CNN Worldwide, but also at MSNBC and NBC News. And so I asked myself, you know, without the Johns, as all of you agree here, there would be no market for trafficked sex slaves. We wouldn't have any demand, and so therefore supply theoretically would wither. Now, the non-focus on Johns in research, I think, is consistent with how easy it is to be a John. I did an undercover story for CNN. I posed as a John, as I was mentioning earlier, and we visited that underground brothel that I was mentioning. It was in Indonesia. And I went down into this brothel. I selected a 15-year-old girl, and we'll call her May, as we did for the story. And when she came down along with all the other girls, it was like a, it was like a going to buy meat. Fluorescent lights. There was a glass, and I was standing next to the madam, and she was suggesting, you know, as the 35 girls marched in front of me in single file, which one was best, you know, which one was fun, which one was most popular, which one was older, which one was younger, which one was the prettier one, which one was the uglier one, which one was AAA, what was USDA, AA, which one was the freshest, which one was the oldest. That was the way she talked about these girls in front of me. And that was my first exposure to it. So I picked May. May was worth $25 for one day. And that was her price. So I pointed to May, and she got her things, and she changed out of her negligee, and she got her bag. And I remember the picture, because I had an undercover camera, as she was walking up the stairs in front of me, because we were coming up from the basement. And in the bag, and I look back at the picture, you could see a teddy bear out of her bag, which was symbolic of who she is and was, right? A young girl forced to have sex for $25 a day. And if May was caught at any point in that process, guess who would have been arrested? May. Me? No problems. Richard, you paid $25. Go. She would have been arrested. Who would have been beaten? Who were the pimps and the strong men that would have caused bodily harm? It would have been on her, not me. And here I was, the guy doing, theoretically, the bad guy. So we told her story. We asked her if it was okay. We went through all sorts of different levels of approvals inside CNN to make sure that we were treating her as she should be treated along the way. And we told her story. Now, for that story, I worked with a fantastic organization that is now UN Women. It was UNIFEM back in the day. And one strategy they were using at the time was that they would try to combat sex tourism, which is traveling from one country to another, leaving your country so that you would not be beholden to the rules and the laws of your country, to another country where the rules said, hey, it's okay to do what I just told you. And so sex tourism was very popular in Southeast Asia. And what they would do at the time, UNIFEM and certain countries, is they would publish the names of Johns. There it would be in the paper. And guess what happened? Went down. That's right. Demand went down. Surprise, surprise, right? So human trafficking for sexual exploitation is an example. When I think of women's rights, when I think of he for she, when I think of because I'm a girl, that you cannot forget. And while the discussion today is about gender equality, and as we look at sexual exploitation as well, it obviously connotes the idea of women and girls, and it really should connote the idea, though, of what men too, and what we can do little by little. And so I know today we're meeting in New York, and the conventional wisdom tells us that in this great city, in this great country, that the United States theoretically should be one of the leaders in gender equality, right? And it should be free of inequalities, right, and the worst outcomes. When we talk about human trafficking and sexual exploitation, that they cannot be here. That's impossible. It's not going to be here in the United States. But I will reaffirm numbers you know. Women in this great country, they make 78 cents for every dollar that a man does for the same job in America. There are 60,000 slaves right here in this country, in America. And every 45 seconds, a woman is sexually assaulted here in America. And the reason, and I like to go to Byron Hurt, who's an activist who talks about this very passionately, he says a big part of the problem here is how simply that the way we talk about girls and women, as I was intimating at the top of these remarks, and what we think we need to do as men to be men, that idea, that stereotype, to be masculine, to be manly, to be able to reach that idea of manhood. And it's really a herd-like mentality. It's a herd-like mythology of what we need to be as male and what that gender stereotype might be. I mean, here's some of the words that we might listen to. In the United States, if you're masculine, how do you talk about women and girls? They're hoes, right? They're shaking butts. They're rubbing up against men. That's the fashion, right? And that's how you're a man. You're pimping when you do well with the ladies, right? You're a player. And then if you aren't and you stand up for equality and women's rights, what are you called? You're called gay. You're called queer, right? Yeah, you're called words that have this twisted sort of idea of what is right. And they're all derogatory any way you slice and dice them. And every country in the world shares that problem, right? Those words and those stereotypes of what it means to be a man. But those are just U.S. Analogies for what we do and the way we talk about women and girls, which leads to sexual exploitation. And that's the unfortunate bad renaissance that I want to talk about as we start today. But now I'm going to shift gears and talk about what I believe is the good renaissance and what is so enlightening to me as I think about what is happening. It's an equal and opposite to that bad renaissance I'm talking about. And maybe you feel this. I don't think there's, and you know, we're not all that old in this room, but I think that there has never been such good energy, such good awareness, this impetus to treat our sisters and our mothers and our daughters all as equals, right? And I see it wherever I go, whether it's here in the United States or whether it's abroad in Spain or Brussels or Asia. The energy is there, and you can just see that with the he for she movement in terms of where men are, and you also can see it with when we use the word being a feminist. Like, when have we been able to say, I'm a feminist, and that's awesome? We just have to think back to the 70s when you say, I'm a feminist. You're like, who is that person? Who is that person? And so the energy is fantastic, and there are organizations up and down this great country of ours and around the world that tell me it's okay. There's Not For Sale, and the way that they're fighting against gender inequality and slavery is by looking at businesses. Their idea is, well, how can we create social entrepreneurs and fund them so that we can take out trafficking, labor slavery, and sex slavery up and down the processes of business while still making a profit. There's Tao right here in New York City, which is a private equity firm, and it's trying to raise $1 billion to invest in supply chain inefficiencies where we have labor slavery. It's looking at how one business can buy a widget from another and weed out all of the labor slavery that is in the space. And guess what? If you're not doing that as a business, they call you out. They call out the Fortune 500 for what they're doing when they include labor slavery. And then there's like these really awesome people that you get to meet, not only those like all of you in this room. And there's folks that I draw energy from that I've been able to meet in my storytelling. Because when you meet those real people on the ground, then you're energized. And I have to talk about George. I was there with Plan International, and he was in El Salvador, and he was a young dude in high school, and this is the way he described it to me. He said, if I get my girlfriend pregnant, his community would absolutely call her out and ostracize her. They would treat her like a pariah. And he told me, he was like, but I would be seen as macho, right? The pimp, if you will, the good guy. But George decided, despite being 16 years old, that he loved his girlfriend so much that he instead would become an evangelist, because he didn't like that at 16. And his religion became treating girls as equals. He wanted to give them the same rights and privileges that he had. And so he would put on a pink T-shirt for Because I'm a Girl, And he would hold these after-school trainings. This is El Salvador. He would put on these after-school trainings with other boys to tell them, this is the way you need to treat women. This is the way you need to think about them. And that was his new gospel. That message, that wearing pink, that, hey, I don't care what you call me. This is about one human to another. And he got called names, and he told me he lost friends along the way. And he told me, though, that he left the old pack because they were never his friends. It didn't matter to begin with. George, at 16. Now, Because I'm a Girl is so important. It's run by Plan International, as Yana was mentioning. I call Plan International an amazing thing because it's in 70 countries, has $1 billion turnover, but who's heard of it? It's been around for 8 decades. It's an amazing on-the-ground place, and they're making some amazing strides of changing the idea of gender inequality. But I want to finish with another amazing individual. His name is James Kofi Annan, because we're talking today about the Good Renaissance. We're talking about how men can engage here. And he was also an inspiring individual who I got to tell a story about when I was at CNN. And he himself was exploited for labor, as well as in that difficult arc, which is very slippery, became also involved in sex slavery. But he escaped. His trafficker was a fisherman in Ghana. And what's really amazing is what he did after he escaped. Because after he escaped from that trafficker, he got himself through college by himself. He became a manager at Barclays Bank there in Ghana. And then you know what he decided to do? He said, I'm going to quit because I'm doing so much good stuff outside of work. I want to follow my real passion. So he started a school called Challenging Heights. And Challenging Heights saves the children from his neighborhood who would be exposed to what he went through, becoming trafficked for labor slavery and sex slavery. And this guy is very amazing and a story that I'm very proud to have been able to tell about him. A child slave, you can think of this, who escapes, gets a college degree, quits to break the slavery cycle. James Kofi Annan is somebody who is leading that idea of that global renaissance of good stuff, right, for equal opportunity. And so I asked the question, which is certainly rhetorical, why should we join James and George's effort? And as men, as we think about this, we should engage because we can say and do what women cannot. We have this idea of what we will talk about of male privilege. Male privilege, for all its negativity, it gives us ability to make some positive change as men. And we are more often, as you know, as was mentioned by Mr. Ambassador, in your remarks there, we are more often the elected officials in Congresses. We are most often those members of Parliament. We are the CEOs in the Fortune 100. Around businesses globally, and we're all the judges in courts around the world. And that's why I believe that trafficking is really not about women and girls, not only about them. It's also about traffickers and Johns who are men. And when I think about gender, it's not just about women. It's also about men and their stereotyped role as male. And when we think about feminism, why I say feminism is not only about angry women, it's also about angry men standing for equality, like me. I'm angry, but I'm also positive. And as the United Nations has put it, I am one of those he for she's. So that's the construct of the way I think about this awesome opportunity that Yana and the COTA Alliance has brought us together for today. So thank you for listening.
Thank you so much. I think I agree there's some sort of energy and maybe a kind of an awakening going on. So this may be good timing to talk about these issues. And so grateful you're all here. In the interest of time, I would like not to introduce the other speakers, panelists. You have all of it is here on this piece of paper. But I'd like you all to come up here, because I'm aware that some people have to leave a little early. Do you have, if you have a specific questions now for Ambassador Sauer or for Richard, maybe you could pose them now and then we can continue. We had been thinking about some questions ahead of time, and I know Richard had a very good suggestion for the panelists. Let's focus on solutions. You know, maybe think of three things that, you know, you can do. So let's keep that in mind. And then I'd like to invite all the panelists to come up here. It doesn't matter what order you speak in, except I would perhaps like to start with Antonita Zhang from UN Women, who probably has a very large, you know, sort of umbrella view of the situation. Speakers, please try to, when you introduce yourselves and your organization, just try to keep it to 5 minutes. We have Angelina is here, and she's the timekeeper. She's going to raise a finger if you go over your time, okay? And then after that, we can take, you know, open up for a general discussion at the end. But as I said, if you have specific questions now for Ambassador Sauer or for Richard Liu, you could step up to the microphone and do that. Thank you.
Fantastic. Jana, thank you. And why don't we do that very quickly for all of our panelists here? I'm glad that it's not a mantle, as they say, because sometimes we get mantles and we're saved by one. But this is about talking about how men can engage. Mr. Ambassador, you've already introduced yourself, but I'd like to very quickly go to each individual, if you could briefly and quickly talk about why you are involved in this conversation about engaging men when we talk about gender equality.
Well, thank you so much for asking the question. I work with UN Women before UNIFEM for about 9 years. And I always, I was, when I started, I was one of the few guys in the organization, and I was always a little bit puzzled that in the annual report there were no pictures of men, whereas we work on gender equality. And I started making a fuss and started arguing that you, in order to achieve gender equality, you have to involve men, you have to engage them. And at the time, it was met with some frowning and opposition. And later on, it became more accepted and then encouraged. And I think one of the elements that we have been missing in the discussion, and I'm still trying to argue more for it, that we have to explain better as an organization and also as a movement what's in it for men. The Secretary General always says it's the right thing to do. As if, you know, and of course it is the right thing to do, but there is a lot for men to gain. And that aspect is not underlined. It is always as if men have to give up. And my view is that when men engage in gender equality, women's empowerment, they become richer as a result. They get better relationships with their kids, with their partners, right. And they become happier. So I think that point should be made much more. I think more men will come on board that way.
And your name and who you work for.
My name is Anthony de Jong. I'm Director of Resource Mobilization of UN Women. It was a big challenge when UN Women was born, when it was started and established in 2010, that it was met with so many expectations. There was a lot of political goodwill, but unfortunately it was the time of a political economic crisis. So on funding, it has been a rough ride. Very happy with the support of Finland. Ambassador didn't mention that at one point Finland was our number one donor with a core contribution of 28 million. Finland is not the biggest economy on the planet, so teaching a lesson to the big G7 economies, and we look at Finland as one of our big inspirational donors.
You were shaking your finger at some folks there, Tone. I can tell.
Thanks. I'm Pablo Freund. I'm the COO and co-founder of B-Girl. We're a company that makes menstrual hygiene products, and we distribute them globally. We're trying to build the first really global brand of reusable menstrual hygiene products, trying to change the industry and drive a new innovation model for the products, what they really mean to the lives of women and girls around the world. Trying to take another look at what this industry actually has to do with the lives and empowerment of women, and trying to intervene in a leverage point that enables millions of women to stay in school and therefore gain access to all the opportunities that the men in their communities have as well.
Fantastic, thank you.
Hi, I'm Andy Betwee. I'm a partner here at Proskauer. Thank you, by the way, for giving us the opportunity to host. We're very pleased to do that and to have everybody here today. So Proskauer is a large global law firm. We've been around for over 140 years. We've got over 700 attorneys in every major market around the globe practicing all areas of law. And for much of that time, Proskauer has been a champion of women's empowerment and women's improvement of women's position in the workplace and the legal field. We named our first female partner in 1965, which hadn't been for around for 140 years. Doesn't seem like that long ago, but it was before I was alive, and it was before many major law firms were promoting women to partnerships. So we were sort of in the vanguard of that. We have women partners on our executive committee, which is our essentially our governing body, our evaluation committees, our hiring committees, all the important governing bodies of our firm. We have female heads of practice groups and offices. And importantly, you know, we've had many successful women become partner and become counsel, you know, be elevated exactly at the time when they are in their sort of prime childbearing years and dealing with those decisions and taking caregiver leave. We have found ways to successfully continue the promotion and elevation of women who are at that period in their lives, because it tends to coincide with the period in your life where you're making that elevation to the next level of your career. And it's really required a tone at the top at Proskauer. I think in law firms, you know, big law firms anyway, these issues of hiring equally and paying equally, the pay gap is not necessarily an issue at the associate level. That's not because of any altruism of big law firms. It's really more a function of the fact that law schools these days are roughly half women, and so that's the pool. And the firms tend to pay in lockstep, so you pay the same. So we don't have those issues at the associate level. The issues that we focus on, that I can talk about a little bit more later, are in the retention and the promotion of women, where there is still a gap.
Right. Thank you.
Hi, I'm Jonathan Kalin. I founded an organization called Party with Consent, and our effort is to amplify the healthy voice of sexual violence prevention and promote healthy masculinities, primarily on high school and college campuses. And I sort of stumbled into this in what people in the space have deemed accidental activism. When I was a sophomore at Colby College up in Maine, which is about 5 years ago, I was named captain of my school's men's basketball team, and I was named president of a group called Male Athletes Against Violence, and I joined that because it felt so simple. I was a male athlete, and I was against violence. Although it did cause a rift at the school, and particularly because in my sophomore year, there was a pretty high profile, for Maine at least, case of sexual exploitation amongst the football team at the school that led to 10 to 15 of the players being either suspended or expelled. And if you can imagine, that created my experience in college as almost feeling like being on the inside of the two opposite sides of the stereotypical debate, right? The feminist anti-violence space where Male Athletes Against Violence was situated, and the athletic space where the captain of the men's basketball team is. And so in the athletic space, there was sort of a frustration. They didn't realize, why is everybody being so sensitive about this? 15 of our friends are gone from campus. And in the anti-violence space, there's a lot of my own education. Oftentimes I found myself as one of the only men in that conversation, if not always the only heterosexual man. And I learned a lot in that space, but there was a lot of anger, rightly frustrated about how this was just the tip of the iceberg, that there was this culture beneath all of this that led to these problems. And that ran concurrent with a campaign, if you can call it that, that if you look it up, it still exists and is pretty prominent, that reads "Party with Sluts" on neon impact font on party tank tops. And so with this being my context, I figured, what if we could use this forum that was catching attention on college campuses amongst students and use it to amplify something that we could all agree about? And so there's a couple of these stickers on your table, but appropriating that logo for Party with Consent. All I really thought I was going to do was print a couple hundred tank tops, but people were really excited about everything that it stood for, and a lot of people were having questions about consent on college campuses at the time. And from there, in 2014, in the spring, Obama's administration had a 90-day task force to look into on-campus sexual assault, and that came with a lot more interest in what we were doing, and so I'm lucky enough to still be able to travel to colleges and universities and now high schools to do workshops on not just gender equality and breaking down unhealthy masculinity, but also movement building and social entrepreneurship.
And you have saved us from the mantle, but it's acceptable today only because, as I was saying earlier, that we are engaging men today. Otherwise, we would not allow this conversation without 50-50, but please.
Thank you. Hi, my name is Opta Garg. I'm a program associate with Promundo DC. Promundo is a global organization working in about 20 different countries. We started in 1997 in Rio, in Brazil, working primarily on violence prevention in the favelas, but have now expanded into a number of different countries around the world, including the United States, to work on violence prevention, gender equality, et cetera. We work to engage young men and boys, and fathers on gender equality, promoting positive imagery and positive role models, and try and change attitudes and behaviors when it comes to gender equality and engagement on issues such as sexual and reproductive health rights, violence prevention, et cetera. We are an applied research organization, so what that means is that we use research to create evidence-based programming and policy in order to impact the greatest change. Some of our research include the International Men and Gender Equality Survey, the Images Survey, which was created with the International Center for Research on Women. What that is it's the largest survey to understand men's attitudes and behaviors on issues on gender equality. And we also incorporate women's opinions and reports on men's behaviors. And using this data, we have been able to work and gather data from 16 countries with over 32,000 respondents to kind of get a better grasp of how men approach gender equality and where we have the biggest entry points to change these norms and these behaviors. So some of the things that we've learned from this data is that there are cycles of violence. Men who have seen violence in their households are more likely to commit violence going forward. This is supported by a number of different other research organizations. What's unique to the images survey is that we've also seen that there are opportunities and cycles of care. So men who have seen their fathers participate in the household are 1.5 times more likely to participate in the household themselves as they grow older. Men who have seen their fathers distribute work evenly and promote less violence have also espoused more gender equitable attitudes. This is really important because gender equitable attitudes with men is more associated with less perpetration of intimate partner violence, more distribution of household chores in gender equitable households, as well as more satisfaction with their overall lives. This data has been able to inform our programs and create programs such as our program P, which is the fatherhood program. This program is a multi-component working, one, with a curriculum working with fathers to have them better engage in child development and in their children's lives, understanding where their entry points and how to deepen their impact there. We've also been able to create campaigns and awareness campaigns to promote positive images and positive role models for fathers, showcasing that care is from both the mother and father. Creating supportive parenting is what we need to do to create better childhood and child development. We've also used this data to support research on state of the world's fathers and state of America's fathers with creative recommendations and entry points for how we can change policy and global policy internationally and on the national level to help build supportive households and supportive care for children.
Thank you. And finally, we made it to the end of the table.
Morning, everybody. My name is Joe Samlin. I'm a senior program manager at the moment with an organization called Breakthrough, which is also an international organization like ProMundo. We focus specifically on culture change and working to make gender-based violence and violence against women and girls in multiple forms culturally unacceptable. So we do a lot of work with culture, changing culture, through culture, et cetera. And a lot of that, because we focus on culture, we don't silo out kind of the men's engagement piece so much as we work with communities and cultures together. So for us, kind of like working with men is a given and a necessity from the beginning. It's kind of the way that we approach it. Happy to talk more about Breakthrough at any point, but we have a website and some materials out there as well. And in terms of why we do the work, I think I don't want to speak for all kind of male activists in the universe, but it's one of the questions that we definitely get the most. It's a question that I get the most, like, oh my God, and why do you do this? And how did you know? And why do you still do it? And you do it for a living, and what's up with that? And et cetera. And it's a very important question because the answer helps us understand why men do care about this, the men that do, and it's a growing number, which is brilliant and wonderful, but we're not there yet, obviously. But it's also a bittersweet question because it still shows that it's not the norm, right? That men don't know about this, men don't care about this, we don't see ourselves as affected by this, et cetera. A lot of folks, and me myself, talk about kind of our engagement in this work and how we got into it as a series of aha moments, right? When did we first realize this was an issue? When did we realize it was an issue that affects us? When did we realize it was an issue we could do something about? Did we realize this was an issue we really have to do something about, et cetera? My first aha moment was towards the end of high school, when it was shared with me that there had been pretty high levels of physical violence and sexual violence and other forms of violence in my extended family affecting a lot of people I know and cared about. Had no idea what to do with that information, and then went off to college and was thinking a lot about that info and what to do with it, and stumbled across the women's group on campus, and they were talking about similar stuff, and I was the token guy in social change for women on campus, which is not an uncommon experience for a lot of us that do this work, for men that do this work. And from there, it was kind of off to the races. Lived in Japan for 5 years, and aha moments around gender-based violence in other countries and how it works and the root causes of it, and came back and learned about men's engagement when I was a grad student and took my first training with Men Can Stop Rape, and then wound up working for them a number of years later, et cetera. It's very enticing for folks with relative privilege who do this kind of work to rest on our laurels and hit a plateau and then stop the journey. I'm an ally now, where's my ally card? And I'm one of the good guys, right? Some of the language that's used out there. And so I push myself, and I'm blessed to have women and other folks in my life that hold me accountable when I start to slow down. The biggest aha for me, which I'm happy to talk about later if we have time, and I talk about a lot, is what accountable men's engagement really looks like. I appreciate the point about having men on the panel to talk about engaging men and the experience of engaging men, right, as men. And yet one of the points we tend to miss is that there's an assumption these days that only men can work with men, and that men are the ones who should be engaging men. And there is a part of that which is like, yeah, we need to do at least the base minimum of work on this issue as the group that is responsible for the majority of violence and violence against women out there. And yet the assumption that men can work with men best is very problematic and part of the whole privilege thing to begin with. Because the reality is that almost none of us as men would be aware of these issues or doing anything on these issues or know how to address issues of gender violence if women hadn't made space for us, invited us in, asked us to do our job, hold us accountable, support us, et cetera. So that's the kind of stuff that I'm most interested in now, is really looking at, right, different ways of engaging men.
We're late to the game. Yes, I would agree. Yeah. Thank you all for your introductory remarks. And now I would like to say, if you can keep all of your remarks to 60 seconds, I would appreciate that, just so we can get through as many questions and topics as possible. So if we can do that, it'd be fantastic. I'm going to get to best practices shortly, but I do want to go to some questions from all of you first, because we've been, me the most, blabbering for some time. Any questions from all of you wonderful people? Please. And then I'll move my way that way, and then I'll go this way after that. Go ahead, please.
Hi, my name is Kuni Gadelikian. I represent nonprofit of working with girls. Actually, what my focus is on. I'm very pleased to hear all of you. This is something that's been coming up. Oh,
Thank you. Hello. This has been coming up for the past week in our circles, and it's, I think, another place that I want to bring up and hear responses from any of you. We know what happened in the last week in the U.S., but we also know at UN that there's this backpedaling of conservatism globally. And we as advocates for women and girls or minority rights or human rights, we're pretty nervous about this. But what I'm hearing in the last week is that one of the reasons it's backpedaling is because we as advocates have been so adamant about fighting for minority rights, we forgot to actually sit down and listen to the white male. And I'm very concerned about that, and mm-hmm. I can understand it. I mean, we all have speak in this room, we're all aware of why we need to fight for minorities and girls' rights and trafficking and labor and all of that. But how do we make sure outside of this panel and the people in this room, we actually include the white male voice who feels like is not being heard.
Right.
They're really afraid we're taking over the world mm-hmm. when we're only fighting.
I have no idea what you're talking about.
Okay.
Something we talk about a lot. Thank you for your question. That's a very good question. Also a question here.
Yes. Hello. So my name is Sabah Ismail, and I represent a young women-led organization called Aware Girls, which is based in the northwest of Pakistan. I have two questions. One is that when we, for example, if like when women talk, when women and girls work on these issues, there are a lot of challenges. But being a man, what challenges do you face working on these issues? There has been a lot of discussion since morning, but I guess it was more general. But what there is can be one specific like challenge. And another question is that, like, you know, there can be some women's rights group who can say that, okay, these are the men who are again taking space for women's rights, working for, like, you know, there may be taking the donor money as well, again, in the name of men, actually, for men working on these issues. So how can you convince, maybe I'm actually now playing the devil part, that how you can convince me, who is a women's rights activist, and saying that, you know, you are, what you are doing is, like, you know, it's not taking space, again, from the women who are already struggling in this male-dominant society.
Ooh, you're laying down the gauntlet today. I like that. I like that. And the question over there.
Thank you. Pardon my cold. I have two questions. My name is Leslie Wright. I'm from Zonta International. My first question is, what can we do to change the language to eliminate negative words that describe mm-hmm. women?
Right.
And I'm not quite sure whether that's the case in other languages, but I suspect it is.
Yep.
You know, I'm reflecting on what happened in the last campaign, that a woman could be treated with the kind of language that she was treated with, and that it would be repeated in the press. And then the second question is more specific to Tan or to Ambassador Sauer, and that is, as a UN volunteer for about the last 20 years, I see women underrepresented in the system, and that men have actually made more roads in UN women in comparison, and I wonder, is my impression true, or do the statistics tend to bear that out? That's a very specific question.
I like all those questions. Okay, so we have three for our panelists here, and no order to how you will answer any of these, but please, my panelists, if you can, and keep your remarks again to 60 seconds if possible.
If I volunteer starting and responding to the last question of my friend from Sonta, which we met before. And this is, it's a very, very timely question, because the UN is having a new Secretary General, and the messages to him from people like us has been that we need more gender parity in the UN, especially on the senior level. And actually, Antonio Guterres, he has committed to this. He has committed to this openly. He has said that there will be a categorical gender parity in the senior level appointments, which he is responsible for. Okay, well, wait and see. At the lower levels, it's a bit more difficult to implement. in the UN system, in the hierarchy, in the recruitment policies. But I think that the trend will be a positive from now on.
And one of those, Mr. Ambassador, one of those, into the panel as well, Mr. Ambassador, is discussion itself at the UN Foundation's annual gala. Ambassador Power to the United Nations sat there in her accepting remarks for the award that was given to President Obama. In so many words was saying, why don't we have a female as a Secretary General? Because we saw we saw who they were considering and the equal numbers of men and women that they were considering, at least publicly. And and she described the difficult process of she being the only woman on the Security Council. And in so many words was saying, it was tough. Like she wanted, and she spent most of her remarks saying, we should have a woman for the first time, a Secretary General. And I think that's where the question is sort of going from top to bottom, how difficult that conversation is at the UN. Or maybe it's an easy conversation, I don't know.
Yeah, well, another 60 seconds now.
Yes, I give you 60 seconds, that's correct.
Yeah. On the election of the Secretary General, I mean, first of all, it was a very, very different process from the previous processes. It was more transparent, and it allowed perhaps more participation also from non-members of the Security Council, and especially from the non-members of the P5, the permanent members of the Security Council. And this kind of generated a movement also in favor of a female Secretary General. And actually Colombia, my colleague from Colombia, she started convening a movement, which we also joined, the Friends of a Female Secretary General. But I think in the end, quality was really what mattered. It wasn't a political compromise. It was simply the fact that Antonio Guterres, he was the best. I mean, this was the conclusion. It wasn't a political compromise. It wasn't a political deal-making result. It was the best individual who made it, and I think that's fair. By the way, with the departure of Samantha from the Security Council, there's a chance that there will be no women on the Security Council next year. None of the 15 might be a woman. It depends a little bit, of course, who President Trump decides to appoint.
To any of the topics?
I'd like to say something specific about UN women, since you asked for it, Leslie. I think when you look globally, it's about 10-15% of staff is male. It's just at headquarter level, there's a few high-level positions that are occupied by guys. Deputy Executive Director of UN Women is a Frenchman, a white Frenchman. And there's a few others, Maurice de Wright, head of administration. So that's why the perception is out there that there are disproportionately a lot of men. But if you look at the whole, it is really not the case. And particularly in program and policy, it's very few and far between the men. Men are mostly concentrated in more technical jobs, finance, IT, and also in operations. I think that, you know, part of our work is advocacy. And like previous speakers were saying, we just have to hammer down and repeat ourselves in different formats. And there was also a time in the Security Council not that long ago that half of the representatives were female. The Brazilian rep was female, Nigerian, well, a substantial number. So it is an up and down movement. And hopefully, when we do the right advocacy, we will have more high level women decision makers, because it's the right thing to do,
right,
and the smart thing to do.
Right, right, right. Lots more questions to answer there. Please go ahead. Anybody, just go for it.
Sure.
Go ahead.
Thanks. I'm going to do 30 seconds on the first and 30 seconds on the second question, if I can. This is going to come off kind of big. I would gently suggest that actually the flip is true. It's not advocates, it's not women, it's not feminists that are stifling the expression of white men and folks with privilege. I would suggest that the majority of it comes from the system that we've set up around masculinity and the dominant story of what it means to be a man. If I'm not allowed to express my emotions because that's how I decided to be and how other men are policing me, then of course if I get upset, I'm just going to explode, because anger and violence are the only ways that, societally speaking, I'm allowed to express that anger, right? So just the frame of it, I personally just want to push back a little against. Strategically, how do we deal with all the the privileged folks like myself, relatively privileged folks who are angry and upset and this, that, the other. Yeah, we got to deal with that. And even though I started my remarks by saying the assumption that men are the only ones who can work with men, this is something I actually think this is men's responsibility to do for the most part. Not that men are the only ones who can do it or we can do it better than women, et cetera, but this is our job to check ourselves and each other. We police each other on masculinity all the time, whether we commit overt violence or not, and we support these systems that lead to this frustration, that lead to us being not fully human, as other folks spoke to, et cetera. It's up to us to make that change in partnership with women, leadership of women, et cetera. But I would say it's a different frame. Strategically, we can talk. That's a whole semester-long class on how to deal with that and push back. That wasn't 30 seconds. I'm sorry.
That was not 30 seconds.
That was not. This gets a lot of my points out. I appreciate the devil's advocate question. I can't guarantee you that men and the men's work and men's engagement work isn't taking up more space in terms of resources, money. I can guarantee you that it is. A lot of money from the beginning of men's engagement has gone to programming in places that really there was no accountability and no evaluation, et cetera, in the beginning. And there's still a lot of privilege tied up in that money coming from victim services sometimes and women's organizations. It's something we really have to look at on a meta-global level and on an individual level, because the wage gap plays out in feminist work as well, which is to be expected because the feminist and the activist spheres are still part of the culture that we're trying to change. But there are men who commit violence in this work, and women and trans folks and other folks that commit violence in this work. But these problems still play out within it as well. We need to do much better in the movement at being intentional and accountable, how on an individual, on a community, and an organization
right.
On a global level, we do this work. And ProMundo is a great example of how to do this work accountably.
Okay, Joe.
Sorry.
Joe, I do that again. I'm going to come over to the other end of this table. Pablo.
Yeah. Well, just from the perspective of working in enterprise, and I often find myself working in development programs, actually with Plan International. And
you're a good guy.
I'm often the only man talking about menstruation. I often joke that I make it a point every day to talk to someone about menstruation that normally wouldn't.
You're
going to a lot of dinner parties.
So one of the things that I would notice in the case of the white male is actually, like the senior positions that you're saying are actually filled, a lot of the positions that I find that I interact with other white men working in the menstruation space for me is actually in the very structured environment. So actually, the big global companies that make menstrual hygiene products, their senior executives are men, even in the female care divisions. And then when you actually look at who's doing the work on the ground, it's actually women doing the work on the ground. And there's a lot of things that even though I want to do and I consider myself a stakeholder, I can't do. So why do I do this work? Because I'm human and I'm very qualified to do human rights work. But actually, globally around the world, there are issues and stigmas around menstruation that a man cannot solve by himself. So we find that a lot of the work on the ground, education and the destigmatization has to be done by women and also by men, and engaging boys and girls at a very young age. So I think it's also about educating and changing culture. The moment
right.
that you said is
right.
ripe.
That's right.
Starting at a very, very young age.
Very young. So there are three questions that we have not answered yet, and I want to make sure we answer them in 60 seconds. And that is the question of how to change language. The question was about white male minority rights, that sort of dynamic. And the third question we have not necessarily answered, but I think we have generally, is challenges for men on this issue. So if any of our other panels here can address those three questions in 60 seconds.
Sure, I can take a stab at probably the language one as well as the white male. And as a Manhattanite, I'm probably not the best representative of white male America, but I'll give it a shot anyway. I think the key to all this is to, a huge key to all this is to personalize it and to create a sort of forced empathy and find ways to get men to take ownership of that. And I think, you know, look, we all have mothers and wives and daughters and girlfriends. I mean, there's a connection there for every man. who will be able to have some empathy for that. And to get to tie that into the language point, which I think is integral, just as a viewer of it, I think that the it was like during the Super Bowl, and it was sort of weaponized during the election as well. But this method of, and there's a bunch of stuff online, this method of showing, you know, girls, women, grandmothers saying these things that are, these mean things, these vicious things that are anti-women or insensitive, is really powerful. Because when I see, you know, a girl that could be my 11-year-old daughter saying one of these things to my face through the TV screen, it hits me hard, and I realize all of a sudden I'm in those shoes, and I think that's very powerful. And it also, and then men also saying the things, right, that, you know, be a man kind of stuff. When I see somebody of my vintage saying that and how ridiculous it sounds, you know, it hits home. I think that also has a fun, and using those words in that way, instead of sort of having them be secretive and bad words, and, you know, again, that empowers those words. And I think when you bring them out in the open and people see how ridiculous they are, it neutralizes them. And I think that over time can help change the dialogue.
I just want to kind of build off of some of the points that have been made. In terms of working in this space, it's really important that this work is done with women's organizations, not against women's organizations, working in cooperation. So when we work in the different countries, when we work on the ground, what we're always doing is looking to partner with key stakeholders, and those are women's rights movements that are already been doing the work that we're looking to do. And how do we support and elevate and leverage the work that they're already doing? So really working in cooperation with one another in order to reach those key goals and those key objectives is how we approach these programs. In terms of language, I think that what we always try to do is promote critical reflection, not only in the people that we work with, but within ourselves and within our facilitators. So we work in programming curricula is constantly engaging and questioning, ensuring that our values are always questioned, our biases are always questioned, and promoting that within with the participants that we work on, and not just within themselves and trying to change their language in general, but how do we promote that they question their social and their peer groups, and trying to change the social expectations. A lot of times we can be complicit by not challenging each other and not questioning the norms that we're perpetuating. And so how do we build within the youth, within men, within women, within all of our key community groups on how to challenge critically and build that kind of empathy so that these social expectations aren't that, okay, we're going to let this slide because it wasn't that bad of a word. But how do we say this is not the way to approach this, this is how we challenge it, and this is where the first step.
Yeah, and I really build on those two questions again about you know, the backpedaling to conservatism and challenging language of negativity to women. I just sort of have my thing sort of narrative. And I grew up in Western New Jersey playing basketball, so I didn't realize it at the time, but it's like a pretty conservative upbringing, particularly when I look at my social media and things like that now. And I was having a conversation with one of my friends because he sees Joe tagged me in a lot of stuff for now or other things that I want to put on social media to spread awareness. And I'll spare the conversation, but it was very much getting personal about it, because when it comes to some extent, nobody's saying, like, no, I think sexual assault should happen. But it's rather like, you know, that's just boys being boys or things like that. And we can talk about it more later. But the conclusion was sort of like he came into the conversation saying, for women, if there are sharks in the water, don't go swimming. And by the end of it, the question was, well, why are there sharks in the water in the first place? And so those are sort of the things that I think creating a personal connection can do. And another piece about the language, I think, you know, I've done a lot of playing dumb around this negative language, whether it's to women or the LGBTQ community. And one example of that was at Colby, we had an event called Mr. Colby, which was a spinoff of women's beauty pageants, but it was for guys. And this big, like, 6'6" guy on my team, he said, oh, dude, like, I'm not going to Mr. Colby. It's so gay. And to sort of ask the question, I was like, you know, man, like, I've never been to this event. What happens at it? He said, oh, there's just, like, a guy who gets on stage and starts taking his clothes off, and all the chicks start, like, screaming for him. And it's like, sounds like probably the definition of a heterosexual event. So moments like this, where I think we're so numb to certain elements of degrading women with language, that really come back to a centralized idea of how we try to identify and police other men around their masculinity. So, you know, those are two lighthearted pieces that I use with narrative that I hope to shine light on it, but oftentimes it is harder.
Yeah, and I think just to reflect on all the questions that are language specifically, I police myself. I don't like to say you guys. I police myself on that. That's specific. I also, when I think of the way I'm constructing my sentences, I am not saying she was raped. Somebody raped her. I'm very conscious of the structures of my sentences. So I think it's something that's practical that you can do is just think specifically of those words, and I'm very conscious of that. The idea of, I think, what you're alluding to, which is minorities, and I know you have a question too, and the white male, and are they being heard? The numbers show this when we look at this election that you're head nodding towards, that the president-elect got votes from all slices of America, regardless of ethnicity and gender. So what does that tell us? It's not about the white male. It really is more of the fact that we allowed some other things to be secondary or tertiary to the decision as to who we might vote for as a country. And that issue, vis-a-vis why we're here today, which is gender equality, we realized it was number 2, 3, 4, or 5 on that list. Because for all of us here, that's a third rail, right? That's a third rail. You don't talk about women like that consistently and say, you'll vote for that person. I think that's the way what you're really asking. But what I think we learned by the numbers is that issue became 2, 3, 4, or 5 on that scale. So it wasn't necessarily about the white male. It was about all of America saying, we are like what minorities are going through in all of these places. So we can't slice and dice that intersectionality that is now the American voter. Just to answer your question on that, which I think one of the questions here on the follow-up was about that. They're coming in fast and furious. So my friends here, I'm just going to read them, and you're going to have to react to them in 60 seconds. How can we stop lumping together women, minorities? Women are not a minority. That's one question. This one to the group, often when working to promote women's advancement and leadership, there is some backlash from men who view it as unfair or even as reverse discrimination. Is there any component of Proskauer's diversity and women's sponsorship program that targets men to make them allies to the cause? I guess that's to you, Andrew. And this is...
That was a plant.
I'm planting all sorts of questions here. Can we really risk instrumentalizing the gains men and boys can get from treating women with economic, political, and social dignity? Can we really risk instrumentalizing the gains, quote-unquote, that men and boys can get from treating women with economic, political, and social dignity? I guess, is that question saying you're doing that because it makes you better and it makes it too cool? Is that who wrote this question? Is that correct? Like it's a cool thing now that you wear it and you utilize it for not the reason why you want to do it.
It was more so going back to Anthony's original remarks about that we need to underscore the gains that men and boys can get.
Need to underscore it. Got it.
That we need to underscore it more. But the latter half of my question was saying, doesn't that risk dehumanizing females all over again and forcing feminism to march up a descending escalator?
I get it. Okay, great. Thank you. Okay, that's to you, Tone. Mitt Romney, binders full of women and the reaction, backlash in the media and society. Please comment on that. And the pitfalls of attempted feminism. This is all really good. In the frame of men's roles and gender equality. All right, I'm just going to go with those four. We've got about another 10 or 15 minutes here. So, again, please keep your remarks short if you can and pithy. Thank you.
Can I
start? Sure.
On the question you asked, it's a very difficult question you asked. My intention is just to get men more enthusiastic and get them more in the conversation. I really enjoyed what you said about the aha moments in your life, and it made me reflect about my own aha moment was when my father passed away. And he was rather young, he was in his 40s, and when he was in his final days, his main worry was, have I been a good father? And of course, I always remember that we had to reassure him he was a very good father. He was worried about it because he didn't spend that much time with us. He was always focusing on his work. I think what it brought me home is that whatever I do with my life, I have to make sure I am a good father to my kids. And also in the husband sphere, at least I cook. I think that's one of the reasons why my wife keeps on extending my contract. And I think in terms of solutions, I think it's very important that maybe at school we teach boys how to cook. I think ProMundo is working with that as a sort of a hook to get boys interested in their activities, you know, to stop violence against women. I think in Mozambique you have activities like that. So I think we have to demystify this whole gender business. And also, men can make clothes and mend clothes and cook. Women can be bus drivers, truck drivers, can ride motorcycles. And I think we need more of that conversation. And then we can understand better what we gain, and it will not be affecting feminism. I think men and men like Trudeau, they have a good role model function, because it can be very cool for prominent men to be feminist, and that they will be followed, I think.
The other three questions, Andrew, we'll go to you because that question was addressed to you about Proskauer.
Sure. So there are a couple of pretty prominent ways that we do get men involved with the program, myself being an example of that. We have several women's empowerment programs here at the firm. I think the two where men do get more proactive, one is in our women's board initiative. We have an overall board initiative where we encourage Proskauer partners and council to join nonprofit or corporate boards. But specifically, there's a focus on women doing that. And we get men involved in that program, men who may have experience, men and women who have experience on boards, but a lot of men to impart their knowledge and help give the women in that program an opportunity. So that's a way for men to get involved. The way that I'm and others are most other men at the firm partners are most involved is through our women's sponsorship program. We have two levels of that program, one for associates and one for women associates, who are sort of a select group that people see as having the greatest potential, and then a group of recently promoted partners and counsel. And what we do is, I'd call it a mentor-mentee program, but it's more than that. It's really a sponsorship program. So the associates are called protégés, and the partners in council are called colleagues. And so you pair off a sponsor with a protégé or a sponsor with a colleague, and then you partner up, and the protégé or colleague goes through training. We have outside consultants. We do it internally as well. But and not all the sponsors are men, by the way. Some of them are women, but it's supposed to be partners who are willing to get more involved and really dig deep and go beyond that simple mentor-mentee relationship and actually take an active role in the fostering and, again, retention and keeping those good people. Because frankly, our true strength is in our intellectual capital and our institutional knowledge, and that goes home every night and comes back in the office, and we want to try to keep that. And so those are two big ways. That's how I got involved. And again, you know, like I said earlier, once you do get involved and take a personal stake in someone, you understand their perspective better. That fosters a program. It's a virtuous circle. And you want to get more people involved in it too. And so, you know, men encourage other men to get involved in the,
right,
things like this.
Who would like to address this? Binders full of women, the pitfalls of attempted feminism. Who would like to address that? Nobody's going to touch that one?
I can address a piece of the pitfalls of attempted feminism. I'm guessing specifically in my experience with men, and particularly young men, that the desire to get engaged when so much, so party with consent on its own is very much an effort to say, get involved with this, being against sexual assault is cool. And I made the faulty decision in creating that to bring along two guys onto the leadership team of what I was doing who were perhaps more on the sort of cool side than the sort of engaged in the actual topic. And that just led for a really significant rift in the way that we were thinking about doing this. And so I know that from mentors of mine in the work, the point where particularly when we're talking about men in feminist work, the idea that coming into a leadership role should really take a number of years and a number of different ways of reflecting on things. As Joe even mentioned, that there's been some claims of violence within men who do this work. I think you know it goes back to the elements of accountability and the elements, the dangerous pitfalls of perhaps instrumentalizing. To use your words, because I brought in some guys who were in it because it was cool, not because of like the actual deep down work. They're still awesome, but it didn't connect with them in the same way.
I use the rule, if it's 51% the good stuff, it's okay. If it's 51% the good stuff, it's okay. Because none of us are perfect enough. But if we're 51%, we're okay. Please address anybody on this panel. How can we stop lumping together women, minorities? Women are not a minority. Also, this is comment on the intersection between race and gender. We've talked a lot about the ability and role of men in gender equality. How does race play a factor? Who would like to address these two questions?
So with a number of our programs, Program H, our program that focuses on young adolescent men, and our program PA, which focuses on fathers, we always try and take an intersectional approach to understand that men and women aren't just experiencing gender inequality, because both men and women experience gender inequality, but that there are also other factors that can inhibit their ability to achieve the types of objectives and equality that they want to. And so what we do in our programs, including our programs in the U.S., is we factor in and we have them talk about that, and we have them engage in that critical, how do you feel as a young man? How do you feel as a young man of color? How do you feel? And then kind of bring that flip side of how do you think a young woman of color also feels? How do you think the young woman experiences the world? And we try and talk about those things. And we understand that it is difficult to navigate this world where you're not only trying to change yourself, but the world is trying to change you as well. So what we always try and do is kind of couple it with a community awareness and community campaign, because we know that they don't exist in silos they exist in the communities that reinforce these inequalities. So really trying to engage in that activism, that awareness that you have a role to play in changing this world, I think that's some of the things that we do try and address. And one of to kind of get a little bit to the instrumentalist idea is that one of the things we always try and rely on is ensuring that our programs are gender transformative, not just gender accommodating or gender sensitive. And when we do that, what we're doing is trying to change their understanding, the way that they see and are aware of their behaviors and their ideas. And we try and rely heavily on evaluations to try and see not only are we changing their actions and their likelihood of engaging in more gender equitable actions, but are they also absorbing the behaviors that inform those actions? Are they not, for instance, with fathers, are they not just going to clinics with their wives, but are they understanding the reasons why it's important for both their partners and their children in going into the clinics, prenatal clinics?
Any other 60-second comments to answer those two questions?
Well, I would.
Pablo, you want to go? And I think Joe wants to go too. 60 seconds, though, please. We're at the end of the morning.
So I'll just say that I find, while I know that I sit squarely in the kind of a male privileged space and that informs my optics, I think that moving the conversation back to human rights and establishing that there are minimums that are regardless of race, gender, even where you are in the world, that there are some standards that we have agreed to as the world, that this is the basis for humanity. I think that is a helpful lens to help bring back the conversation about what we should be doing and not necessarily frame it in terms of gains for white males or any other specific group that may benefit from the movement towards equality and bring it back towards the conversation that we all benefit towards the movement towards equality.
Joe?
I wrote it down and I practiced it in my head as I was listening. I just want to touch on that question because I think that question is, for me at least, one of the key, most important questions in the movement. I think we have, in my experience, absolutely over-relied on emphasizing, yeah, you're going to give up some of these privileges, but you'll get all this shiny new stuff too. And strategically, I get it. Having done work with men, one-shot presentations and long-term work, yeah, we're fighting against thousands upon thousands of years of systematic violence and oppression based on race, gender, et cetera. And so we need to be strategic and get men in the room. And that takes a long time, that change, right? To be able to see the true benefits and humanity in doing the work. So it's balancing out one of the key kind of tenets of this work, which is meeting, you know, you have to meet people where they're at. And especially in men's work, meeting men where they're at. But at the same time, I think we can do a lot better with balancing it out, because when you overfocus on the gains, you're colluding with the privilege, right? Especially if it's men working with men, talking about men, et cetera, the danger is to collude with the privilege. The aha moments for men, for white people, et cetera, those are also a privilege. It's a privilege for me not to realize police brutality existed against folks of color until Black Lives Matter, right? The aha moments are important and they're key, but they're also a privilege. And so we have to acknowledge the privilege piece in the work as well, because that ultimately is the goal, is to break down the privilege and to work towards equity, et cetera. And there are some folks not only in the panel but in the room, sorry to shout you out, Alan, but that do incredible deep work around masculinity and the real reasons why. Because if we overfocus on the gains, then the problem is, as someone said earlier, we stop at what if it was your daughter or your wife. Well, we can start there, but we really can't stop there. Because if we stop there, what does it mean? If it's not your daughter or your wife, it's fair game, right? So the same guy who beat you up if you look at his daughter the wrong way or harass his sister is going to go out and harass women as well. Right? So that's just one of the small ways where if we overfocus on the gains, we're really potentially doing a lot of harm. So I really appreciate you bringing up the question.
We're going to conclude now, and I'd like to get everybody to, in 60 seconds, your concluding thoughts. I do want to answer this last question, though, as my concluding remark, and that is, what is the role of media in influencing men to become more involved in advocating for women? Another question says, how can the media be used to help to grow the movement of men for gender equality? I think there's two ways to answer that. Number one, we just need to talk about women as humans. We need to talk about the difficulties that the panelists have brought up in very real ways, but in parallel ways that are similar to other inequalities that are very straightforward but accessible. I think a second best practice is to involve all media in what you do. Bring them in as members of your board of advisors. Bring them in as a board member. Bring them in to be part of the way you strategize your movement or you're part of that movement. And then they will understand. They will go, duh. But we're not often asked. We're not often asked about this. It's so easy. And once you have us there, you have us forever. Closing remarks, 60 seconds each, please.
Thank you, Richard. I guess as a diplomat, you developed this technique that you ignore the questions which are coming from the audience, but you try to bring across the message you want to bring. And my message is actually about incentivizing the women's empowerment in the labor market. And I can refer you to one great study, which is the State of the World's Fathers from 2015. You might be familiar with it, but they have some really good figures there, and as the figures are very convincing, I'm going to quote them, that if women participate in the labor market at the same rates as men do, it is estimated that the GDP could increase in the US by 5%, in Japan by 9%, in the United Arab Emirates by 12%, and in Egypt by 34%. I think these are quite staggering figures. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Ambassador.
Thank you. I just want to conclude that this was an incredibly helpful conversation, and we should have more of them. I walk away richer and more enlightened, and I'm very, very grateful for the dialogue. Thank you.
Thank you, Tom.
Likewise, happy to be here. Just want to share, just like I said, that I try to talk to people about menstruation when they normally wouldn't. I'm trying.
You're consistent, Pablo. I got to tell you. Yeah, you are just. Yeah.
But I'm also working on my listening skills, and I realize that that's what I need to do more and more. So I think maybe a key takeaway is to listen more. The things that we do at my company, the products that we make, have been designed because we were listening to the needs of women in difficult circumstances, and that allows us to make a product that really works in their context, in their lives. And in that same way, I would say, I think in every other aspect of the equality space, we have to be listening for what the needs are so that we can actually meet them. And then I would just really advocate for us to take the notion that while men and women are not the same, we can aspire to equality in so many ways. And so equality, gender equality is not about making us the same, but in celebrating our differences and building something together.
Andrew, 60 seconds.
So I think the takeaway that I'd like to give on just for thinking about implementing these types of programs that I mentioned in the workplace, maybe your own organization or others, is that these programs don't run themselves. We have seen tremendous advancement and success with these programs because we've devoted the resources to having a diversity and inclusion team whose job specifically day to day is to make sure that we have these programs, that they're developed, well thought out, and carried out. And I think that is critical. You obviously need the involvement of, just taking again the law firm as the example, you need the involvement of the partnership. But the partnership can't run it because they're busy being a partnership. You need to devote the resources to have a team on the ground that's literally, that's their sole reason to come to work, is to develop and implement these programs. And that will ensure their success. And it has with Proskauer over the last few years in particular.
Jonathan.
Yeah, I'll close taking part of the question about media. At least in the way that I've been introduced to it originally, not just media as the news and as different places where you might see Richard, but also that like media encompasses TV and everything that kids are seeing on the internet and movies. For me, when I reflect on my experience growing up, those were my forms of literacy around not just how I was supposed to act as a young heterosexual man, but also specifically my work is specifically on college and high school campuses, what am I supposed to do around sex with that identity in college? And so there's this clip from the movie Superbad that I show a lot where one of the characters is saying to the other one, they're in high school, they're about to go to college, they say, you know, like how girls are saying, oh, we like got so drunk last night, we shouldn't have had sex with those guys. We could be that mistake. And so thinking about quotes like that, and obviously thinking about the inundation of media around things like pornography, particularly for the young male mind, and how that is basically shaping sexual education for them, devoid of any space in the home that I didn't have or at school that I also didn't have to undo some of those learned ideas, is dangerous. So for me, I think there's this really powerful piece around the news and things like that that Party with Consent has gotten a lot of positivity from and be able to amplify its message. But when you think about it on the entertainment side, I think there's still a lot that we can do in realizing that there's free speech, but also simultaneously recognizing that particularly young men are learning their what they think their identity, sexual behaviors are supposed to be, which oftentimes should be broken down.
Apta.
First of all, thank you all for having us here and inviting me to come speak. I just want to kind of emphasize some of the things that have been said, and I think I do encourage the promotion of positive images of what a masculinity can be, promoting that as a way for young men and boys to think about what they could be going forward, and building those images in their minds and in their culture will have those types of changes and impacts that we want to see, as well as kind of encouraging critical and personal reflection and challenging those types of norms, even when they're minimal, will be will have those types and create those environments where we can kind of create new social expectations and new cultural norms that can really encourage more positive forms of masculinity.
Thank you. Joe.
And so often those healthy norms and role models exist already. They just get drowned out by the dominant stories of what it means to be a man. So a lot of times it's just creating space for those stories to come forward. I want to say that Breakthrough in the U.S. focuses mostly on ending gender violence and changing culture in college and university life. We have a lot of programs, some information on the tables, a website, you can talk to me, et cetera. I want to just acknowledge that we did talk in a relatively binary way about gender today, men and women, boys and girls, and that is just not the nature of reality, scientifically or culturally, that there's a spectrum of gender, right? And so I just want to just bring that into the room. My main point today, again, is just about accountability and being more intentional with how we engage men on a micro and a macro level. A quote that a lot of people use from a woman in the UK named Kelly Temple says, men who want to be feminists don't need to be given a space in feminism. They need to take the space they have in society and make it feminist. And that blew my mind when I first read it, and still, but I think there's a lot of truth there. Lastly, I want to say that obviously talking about this stuff can be intense for some folks, so there are folks in the room. I'm happy to talk with folks, et cetera, if people need resources, especially the great work you do when you talked about it, Richard. Some of that was really important and hard to hear. So if folks do, either now or later, there's resources available, so please reach out. And I just want to end also by echoing the thanks to Coda and Proskauer and everybody here who put this together, as well as all of the women and especially the survivors and victims of gender violence in different forms that have always been and unfortunately probably will continue to be for the foreseeable future the drivers of this work, which means that we really need to step up, the rest of us, especially as men, and really take more of this work on ourselves. But thank you to the fellow panelists and everybody here for making time for this today.
And with that, we conclude the largest panel I have ever moderated in my career. But if that is any indication of the energy behind this, that is very good. So I thank you, all 99 of you, for sitting on this table with me today. And Jana is already here, so Jana's going to finish it up for us.
Yeah, well, there's not much more to say, or actually there's a ton more to say, but we can't stay here forever. So thank you so much to Richard, Ambassador Sauer, all our panelists. I think it was very inspiring, and obviously you all are great role models. One thing we didn't even touch very much on, actually, is of course where you start with the little kids, the boys, in the home, in the school, and, you know, what parents and you know, how mothers raise boys. You know, a lot of times women also perpetuate the gender stereotypes, and you know, what the schools can do, etc. So that's a whole other different conference, I think. There's a lot to cover there. But you all said some very inspiring things, and we have a lot of food for thought. So let's continue in whatever sphere we are working in to try to bring this, you know, push this issue forward. Thank you all so much for coming. And I think we can, we have a little bit more time to stay here. I know some people have to leave, but I think for all the panelists who can stay, you know, if you're available for, you know, one-on-one conversations, and also, you know, meet and mingle with each other. And thank you again to Proskauer, and thank you also to all of our lovely interns and volunteers, you know, without whom we couldn't do it.